So chapter 5, supporting hard drives. This chapter we're learning about the different technologies used inside a hard drive, also dealing with the communication component of the hard drive to the rest of the computer. We're going to talk about how to select and how to install a hard drive. Lastly, we're going to kind of wrap it up with tape drives and floppy drives. They're not as prevalent, but I mean, they still exist, so we do have to discuss them. So when we talk about a hard drive, typically they come in two sizes, 2.5 inch and 3.5 inch. And that is the width of the actual drive. 2.5 used to be only for laptops, but not anymore. There's a newer hard drive technology out there right now called SSD, or a solid state drive, and they actually measure 2.5 inches wide. A traditional desktop hard drive is 3.5 inches or 3.5 inches. So that's not just for desktops, that's for pretty much anything other than a laptop. The important thing here is, why is the 3.5 not able to go for a laptop? An important thing to remember is size. When you think of a laptop, they're fairly small. So you want something that's going to be fairly small for the laptop. If we had to accommodate an extra inch of a hard drive for the laptop, it would just take up way too much room. Also, there used to be a 1.8 inch hard drive. I've never seen this. I've never encountered it. I've never read any articles about it. I can find no information about a 1.8 inch hard drive. So, honestly, the likelihood of someone coming across one of these is fairly low. So, first thing we're going to start off with is we're going to talk about a SSD, or solid state drive or device. Essentially, a solid state drive has no moving parts. It has built-in high-quality non-volatile flash memory, which is stored as an EEPROM chip. Basically, the memory in an SSD functions like a super large flash drive, just a lot better quality chips. So what is the lifespan of an SSD? Just like a flash drive, they can handle only so many read and write cycles to it. So the more times you read and write data to it, the shorter it dies. However, when you look at the life cycle, I think it's like a 5 million read-write cycle. So realistically, an SSD's life is 7 to 10 years. So people look at lifespan and they go, oh, well, it will die soon. No, I mean, it lasts years. I've had one SSD for 8 years now, and it is still running just as fast as it was before. Because SSDs are newer technology, they're expensive. However, they are a lot faster, they're a lot more reliable, and they last a lot longer than a traditional magnetic hard drive, because the magnetic hard drives have moving parts. Because the SSD has no moving parts, it uses less power, so that's a nice benefit. So now let's talk about a magnetic hard drive. A magnetic hard drive has platters, literally a metal disk inside where it actually stores the data. It has a read-write head that goes over the metal platter, and it changes sections of that drive to have an electrical pulse or not. If it has a pulse, then it's on. If it has no electrical pulse, it's off. Everything kind of goes back to binary. All of the pictures, all the videos, everything is stored in binary, just large masses of ones and zeros. Firmware. Firmware is essentially, it's a small operating system that controls the reading and writing of data from any device to any other device. We talk firmware on a hard drive, but your DVD player has firmware. It's just the instructions the device uses to read data from the Blu-ray disc, for example. Okay, so how is data organized on those metal discs? They're organized in tracks, which is a giant circle around the disc, and then the disc is also broken up into pizza slices. And wherever there is a track and a pizza slice where they meet up, those sections are called sectors. I have a visual diagram here in a second to show you just to help explain that. Most current drives, each sector or each group is 4096 bytes. I don't think you have to know that. Normally that's just the default, but that's just one of those things that's out there. The first photo I have is going to be of the SSD, and that is the housing and the card itself. The card itself is, again, just memory chips. Realistically, nowadays, an SSD is about half that size, so the actual drive itself, the metal piece, is the same size. However, the internal component is about half the size. Okay, so now this is our magnetic hard drive. It has the two platters, it has a read-write head, and then it has the mechanism to move that read-write head. Now if we take one of those platters and we want to see the tracks and sectors, here is our track and sectors. Again, a track is a circular portion, and then a sector is if you take and just kind of chunk it out like a pizza slice, one sector is just one track. Now, the tracks are going to be different sizes depending on where they're located, because they're going to have that 4096 bytes, but as you get closer to the center, your pizza slice kind of gets narrower, so the actual track has to be a little bit thicker, because again, you have to be able to stick 4096 bytes in there. Versus on top, you're going to have a little bit thinner one because you have more room because it gets wider. So, once we have a nice understanding of tracks and sectors, we have to talk about low-level formatting. And essentially what that does is it goes over the drive and then it will mark what area of the hard drive can be written to at the factory versus for typical home use. Low-level formatting is a very specific type of formatting that the manufacturers do to mark where you want to not have data written to. So it kind of sections off the drive so someone cannot damage it by writing data to something that they shouldn't be able to write data to. For example, the very center, the very innermost track, that's normally reserved. Keeping in mind that this is not the same as a high-level format, which is performed by like a user when they format the drive. When a user formats the drive, they're just wiping the data off of the drive. Low-level, again, marks sections of the hard drive off. Okay, so now that we understand that, how do we actually label those tracks and sectors? They're actually labeled as a logical block address, or LBA address. And that LBA allows for every portion of that hard drive that is accessible to have an address. Just like memory, if we don't have a physical address to where it's at, it doesn't exist. Okay, so how do we determine the actual capacity? We take it how large the sectors are, and we look at how many numbers of sectors there are. That gives us a base characteristic for our drive capacity. Okay, one last technology when we deal with our hard drives is this thing called smart monitoring, and that is a self-monitoring analysis and reporting technology. Basically, it lets you know if the drive is in good working order or if it's having problems. When you start your computer up, you'll actually see when it goes through the scan all of your hard drives. Typically, Smart is on by default and it should say okay. If there is a problem, it will say, depending on your motherboard, smart error, smart issue, smart not okay, something along those lines. Okay, so now that we've gone through the basic technology of dealing with our hard drives, let's talk about the interfaces that is used to connect the hard drive to the rest of the computer. So, for a typical home user, there's two major types: parallel ETA and serial ETA. Parallel being having multiple things of data at once and having the processor process all of that together, versus serial, which is one item at a time. Serial is the current trend of technology for our hard drives, and it's taking over. Parallel is fairly old and it's going away. An issue with serial is when you look at a serial cable, it's just one end and another end. There's only the ability to hook up one device per cable. Versus parallel, you could hook up two devices. Okay, so now let's talk about different external methods. Those could be eSATA or external SATA, SCSI, FireWire, USB, Fibre Channel. Those are all different types of external. However, SCSI and Fibre Channel are also internal ones as well. It's just they're typically not used for a home PC. SCSI, for example, this example of SCSI is more like our parallel ETA. But we have a serial SCSI, which we call that serial attached SCSI. Both of those types of SCSIs are specifically made for business servers. Because it's important to note that the use of an average home user for their hard drive is a lot different than the use of a server in a business. For example, how often does a home user access data off their hard drive? Not very frequently, every day, 7 days a week, 52 weeks a year, 365 days a year. Oh, users are just not made to do that heavy of accessing, while businesses are. So they had to have a better type of technology to access their hard drives. The internal components are the same, it's just that interface, which is slightly different. So again, SCSI and serial attached SCSI or SAS, those are for businesses, business servers, versus serial ETA or parallel ETA. Those are typically for home users. And again, realistically, home users and even the basic office worker, not the office server, but just the office worker, they're going to have SATA hard drives, more than likely. But the interface standards actually came in different types of speeds, so that was another benefit. So the original ETA actually could only transfer maybe 8 megabytes per second. Well, ETA 2 went up, ETA 3 and 4 and 5 went up and up and up. The last ETA version we had, which is called ETA 100 or ETA 6, you could only transfer up to 100 megabytes per second. This really wasn't that good, especially when serial ETA actually came out with faster and faster and faster speeds. Notice these Ultra DMA modes. So older hard drives had what was called DMA mode, direct memory access, and essentially they could access the memory without having to interrupt the processor. That meant it could actually write data to and from the hard drive and memory a lot faster. But with the creation of SATA, we had to have something that would readdress the way that it handles accessing the memory, because now the memory is tied directly to the processor. So we came up with the Ultra DMA 6 mode. You don't actually have to know or understand DMA mode in depth. It's actually no longer prevalent. And as long as you're using SATA, they're all using DMA mode 6. Again, DMA mode is just the way, the standard of communication between the hard drive and memory. That's it. So let's look at our parallel ATA, sometimes called IDE, which is just integrated device electronics. So instead of it being parallel ATA, it might be called parallel IDE or just IDE. IDE was basically what we used to call the ribbon cable, but it just kind of stuck. Here's an example of our 40-pin and 80-pin ribbon cables to connect our parallel ATA. Notice how flat the ribbon cable is. That's a lot of room. So once we did that, we had to have other forms of ways to access everything else. We've kind of already discussed our DMA mode, so now we have to talk about our PIO mode. Again, PIO mode no longer exists. It's just, if we talk about our parallel ETA, we have to talk about our PIO mode. And that is a transfer mode which involves the processor. And I mean, it is slow. Turning on your PC to start Windows might take up to 4 hours, just because the processor had to process every request. Versus DMA mode, which again, it gets to access the memory without involving the processor. When you first start the PC, the BIOS actually detects what drives you have. The hard drives are actually separate timing from everything else. And they may or may not run at different speeds depending on the drive that you have. Serial ATA is now again the new storage. One of the interesting things here is the feature for hot plugging or hot plug. Basically, with serial ATA, they're hot swappable, which means as long as your drive supports it and your drive is installed correctly, you can actually unplug the serial ATA drive without turning off the computer. Now, you want to check your motherboard manual to verify that you're setting it up correctly so that the motherboard will support hot swapping. Here's an example of our SATA data and our SATA power. You'll notice they both have a little L-shaped connector in there. That is how we connect our power and data to our hard drive. Different versions of SATA exist, 1, 2, and 3. Notice here, 1.5 gigabyte or gigabit per second. So SATA 1 uses 1.5 gigabit per second. The ATA standards, or the parallel ATA standards, measured it in megabytes, not bits. Because remember, a bit is the smallest unit that we can measure. versus a byte, which is 8 bits. The most current revision of SATA is our 6 gigabit per second. And right now, it came out in 2009, so that's about 5 years old. And it should actually be replaced here shortly. We've already talked about the external portion of SATA, but let's talk about some purchasing requirements. Essentially, you want to look at your motherboard and see what speeds your motherboard supports for its SATA connection. It will actually say SATA 1, SATA 2, or SATA 3. If you get too fast of a SATA hard drive, it will actually by default go down to the slowest speed. However, it might be easier just to get components that match. eSATA is actually becoming more and more popular, and that's just an external SATA connection that does both data and power. So think USB, just using a different type of cable. So we kind of already talked about our SCSI. Again, primarily using servers. The nice thing with SCSI is you could support up to 15 different hard drives or peripherals on one cable. You could actually daisy chain your devices. How the SCSI subsystem has worked is it gave you a logical number for each hard drive called a LUN. When you look at any hard drive is basically just a logical number, and that gives you your hard drive. So if you look at your computer, for example, and you have two hard drives, you actually have, if they're two separate drives functioning as two separate drives, one LUN per drive. Now if you have drives that are working together and inside the computer, for example, like a RAID setup, they might just have one LUN, even though physically you have more than one drive. I'm going to go over that again when we talk about our RAID portion. But here's an example of what I meant by daisy chaining. One cable, and it actually allows you to daisy chain or connect multiple devices. The issue with the SCSI was, at the very end, you would have to put some form of terminator. And all that would do is send it back, essentially. We already talked about the serial attached SCSI. Again, just like SATA, right now, our SATA cables only allow for the connection of one device per cable. So even though we're allowed to connect more than 15 devices on a single chain, we don't have a cable that can do that. Here are the examples of the different types of SCSI connections, with the bottom two being the most common, and actually more people probably will not see these because as SATA became so prevalent, so is SAS, and again SAS is just the same connector that SATA uses. So now let's talk about how do we select a hard drive. Essentially, you want to look at what adapters or what connections that your motherboard has. Do you have enough room, like physically room? Do you have enough power? What is your space requirement? Does the hard drive match your current existing equipment? For example, if you have a 10-year-old PC, it doesn't have SATA, trying to buy a SATA hard drive might not work. So some other considerations might also be size. If you're running Windows 2000 or Windows XP, they actually cannot run any hard drive larger than 2 terabytes. If you want a 4 terabyte hard drive, you might have to go with a newer operating system that supports it. The next thing is how fast the disks spin. The most common one is 7200 RPMs. However, there are some drives called green drives, and they run at 5400 RPMs. The higher RPMs, the faster the drive. There are drives that run at 10,000 RPMs, but those are a lot more expensive. Because again, the faster the RPMs, the faster they are allowed to read and write data to and from them. Lastly, again, the interface type. Is it going to be SATA? Is it going to be parallel ETA? Is it going to be SAS or SCSI? It all depends on what your motherboard has. Also, power. You have to make sure you accommodate for power. So how do we install it? If once we already picked it out, we have to figure out how to install it. For the SATA, it's not overly complicated. You find room in the case. You verify that you have an open SATA port. You hook up the data cable. You hook up the power cable. And you make sure the drive is screwed in. That's it. However, one of the issues is, are there jumpers? Is there anything that you have to do specific to the drive to get it to function? With parallel ETA, you used to. Also, this slide says never install two power cords at the same time. When you do this, realistically, you can only do them one at a time. I mean, just you only have two hands. And you're doing this with the PC off at the same time, so that's not really that big of a concern. If you don't have an extra SATA connection, you can always buy an add-on card. The add-on cards are called controllers because they control access to the new hard drives. Okay, so we are talking about our parallel ETA. So, if you need to set any type of jumper, you have to read the documentation. So, step one of the actual installation guide is know how your system is configured. Make sure that everything is working properly. You jot down, make sure you have everything for the system documented. Then you start reading over the documentation. You want to make sure that you know what you're going to be doing step by step. It says visualize all the steps. Work in a nice, orderly fashion. Lastly, protect yourself from ESD. Avoid working on carpet. Anything that can cause static electricity or static discharge, be wary of. For example, loose clothing or hair, carpet. Gotta be careful. Read the documentation and again prepare your work area. Handle all the components with care. Turn off the PC, remove the side, install it, hook up the power connectors. Once all the power connectors and everything is functioning, hook everything back up and verify the drives are recognized correctly in the BIOS. Go into the BIOS and make sure they're seamed there. Once they're seamed there, you're ready to prepare the hard drive for use. If you do not have Windows, you'd be installing Windows at this point. If you didn't have Windows, you would be preparing the drive to install Windows at this point. The removable bay, I'm not going to touch, that's completely subjective, but they are a bay that allows you to easily, quickly remove access to hard drive. Easy. Here's an example. Some cases have it, some cases don't. It all depends on your case. So when we were talking about our jumpers or our parallel ETA, this is what I was talking about. So with our parallel ATA, each ribbon cable has two connections. One connection for master, one for slave, or primary and secondary. You actually have to set the jumpers on the hard drive to be either primary or secondary, or master and slave. Sometimes they're color-coded, sometimes they're not. On the motherboard, this is what the actual internal connector would be. It'd be a MEL 40-pin connection. However, there's a shorter version of this, that's for our floppy. Now here are the jumpers. So when you look at the end connection for the hard drive, you actually see a set of 10 pins typically. You look at the hard drive and you verify the section for our jumpers. For example, if you just want one hard drive on that cable, you'd go with the top design. That's no jumper whatsoever. If you want master, you'd select the middle two pins. If you want slave, you'd select the two pins kind of on the right hand side. You don't want to memorize this key. You'd want to check the hard drive that you're working with. That way you can always make sure to use the correct type of key. Okay, so again, when you look at it, a jumper is just a small connection that crosses two pins. So if we're configuring a parallel drive, we use the original first two steps. Then we mount the drive in the bay, put it inside the case, screw it in. So there is no difference between a SATA and a parallel ATA other than the jumpers when we talk about the installation. Okay, so now let's talk about RAID. What is RAID? So RAID is an ability to take two or more hard drives and have them function as one. So why use that? It will improve fault tolerance by writing two copies of data to two different hard drives. That's an example of a very specific type of RAID, but it could also improve data writing, again, copying data to two or more hard drives. So there's different types of RAID. Spanning is normally just JBOD, which is just a bunch of disks. That is, every disk is completely by itself. Then there is RAID 0. RAID 2, or RAID 0, uses two or more physical disks, but it is striped. What it means by striped is if you have two disks in a RAID 0 group, that's called an array. When you set two drives to work in a RAID group, it's called an array. So if you have two drives in a RAID 0 array, half the data is on one, half the data is in the other. It's striped. If you ever think of like a barber, the white and red candy striping, that's essentially what striping is. In contrast, for RAID 0, if you lose one drive, you lose everything. Next would be RAID 1. RAID 1 is called mirroring. That is where you have two drives that use an identical copy of the data on one is on the other. However, you don't get the benefits of RAID 0. The main benefit for RAID 0 is since half the data is on one, half the data is on the other, you get quicker access speed. However, again, if one drive dies, you lose all of it. Mirroring allows you to do one drive, or two drives acting as one, but each set of drives have duplicate copies of data. That way, if one drive dies, you can actually just restart and it will load off the one other copy of everything. You don't lose anything because it's a duplicate 100% copy of the drive that was there. Alright, last one we talk about is called RAID 5. RAID 5 uses three or more drives, and it stripes the data across the drives. However, it uses a parity, a backup functionality, so that if one drive dies, you can actually rebuild it and you don't lose any data. Now, you can actually do variations of the RAIDs. For example, you can do what's called RAID 1 plus 0, or it's also sometimes called RAID 10, or sometimes called 1.5. Lots of different names for this, but it's a combination of RAID 1 and RAID 0. That way, you get the benefits of RAID 0, but you also get the benefits of RAID 1. However, you have to have four disks. So what will end up happening is you'll have your two RAID 0 drives, and then you'll have a RAID 1 mirroring of each of those drives. That way, if any RAID 0 drive dies, you just load the backup disk. So what's the hardware implementation? How do we actually set RAID up? All current day motherboards support RAID 0 and RAID 1 on the motherboard. If you want to verify, just check the manual. There's a software implementation. However, it is suggested that you never use the software version. Viruses are out there that can see the software version, can attack it. So the software implementation we will not discuss because it's not something that people should use. So once we have the drives, what do we do? So essentially what we should be doing is, if we want to set up RAID, we want to get two sets of identical drives. That way, same manufacturer, same speed, same everything, because that's going to work the best. You're going to install both drives. You're going to go into your BIOS, and you're going to turn on the RAID functionality. When we covered our motherboard section, we also talked about how to turn on your RAID functionality. And that's normally under integrated peripherals, and then under whatever they're calling the hard drive technology, that you turn on RAID there. Here's an example of a RAID controller card. All this really is, it allows you to connect four SATA connections. So if your motherboard does not support RAID, you can buy a controller card that does. General directions to install RAID 5 using three or more matching drives. A quick basic analogy for this is, if we're going to set up RAID 5, you would boot the system, go into BIOS, verify the drives are there, verify that you turned on RAID. You would follow the on-screen prompts to make sure RAID is on and saved. When you restart the system, you would have to look at the screen so you can figure out the key combination to enter the RAID configuration. Every motherboard is different, so it just kind of depends on your motherboard. The BIOS version that the Tex is using requires you to press Ctrl-I to enter the RAID configuration. Then you would actually go and select functionality. Here we want to select option 1 to create a RAID volume. Again, all the screens will be different, so you just kind of want to match up the general concept of what you're doing on your own PC, because it will be different. Here's an example. On the left, you want to be able to turn on your RAID in your BIOS. On the right, this is the boot option for the BIOS utility for RAID. You have the ability to create a RAID, to delete a RAID, or to reset. When you do this, it is important to remember that once you turn on RAID, it will delete all the data on that drive. However, if you were doing a rebuild, for example, you have RAID 1 and one drive fails, you can add a new drive to that group or array, and it will not delete the data. It will copy the data from one to the other. Once you click on the Create RAID Volume button, you'll get the ability to select the type of RAID. Once you select the type of RAID, you click on Create Volume. It will create the volume. These are generic screens, so it really kind of depends on whatever screen that you have. Alright, lastly, let's talk about our tape drives and floppy drives. Tape drives are just a different form of long-term storage. So they're kind of like a hard drive in the fact they use serial ATA or parallel ATA or SCSIing. The only difference is it takes a cartridge instead of an optical drive. Tape drives can hold mass amounts of data, and they're pretty inexpensive. They can write once and read many times. You want to make sure that you can copy data to and from it. One of the issues or disadvantages for our tape drives is data is stored sequentially, which means to read from it, you kind of have to start at the very beginning. It's very slow, very cumbersome, and it's easy to be damaged. When you select a tape drive, you kind of just go with whatever type of port that you have available. Last is our floppy drive. Floppy drives are pretty standard. There's just one type of cable for it. If you need it, most systems now you don't have the need for them, but just in case. How do you install a floppy drive? Same way you install a hard drive or an optical drive. You put it in there, plug in the cable, plug in the power, and that's it. I will let you guys read the summaries, but I want to thank you and hope you guys have a great day. All right, bye.